So today we're doing an experiment to look at the phenomenon of metal chelation and using a technique called titration. So to set up our titration apparatus, we will need a burette, a ring stand, and a clamp. Especially if you have one with these nice burette clamps, all you have to do is slide your burette in like that. Big thing to make sure that your stopcock is closed. This will be closed when the plastic prongs are pointed the same direction as the table. There's actually a hole that runs through the stopcock in the same direction as these prongs, so if it is up, it is open and liquid will drain through. If it's sideways, then the hole is not facing up to let your liquid drain through. Because we're doing a titration, we need to know the volume of our unknown and the volume and molarity of our known. So if we take a look at our reagents, we find that the molarity of our EDTA is 0.100 molar. So because we know the concentration of this, we will add this as our titrant to our burette. The easiest way to add things to a burette is usually to put a funnel on top of it. Again, you want to make sure this is closed. And in general, you should have a waste beaker under your burette just in case anything spills. So we'll add our EDTA to our burette until it is full. Something to remember about burettes is they are numbered opposite of the way you would normally expect. Zero is up here at the top near my hands, and 50 is down towards the bottom. So we'll fill this up roughly to the zero mark. If we go a little over, it's not a big deal. There we go. So we're a little under. Again, that's fine. As long as we have enough titrant in here to be able to run our titration, we'll be recording our starting and ending volumes to know exactly how much volume we delivered. To make sure there's no air bubbles trapped in any of this, you always want to open your stopcock, as well as this will make sure that your burette works. Drain a little bit of your titrant out before you start, and now we know there's no air bubbles, the burette is working correctly, and we can now record our starting volume. So this is, again, 3 is up here, 4 is down here, so between 3 and 4. And this is actually between the 3.8 and 3.9 increments. So we can estimate that next decimal place as, say, our initial volume is 3.88 milliliters. Now that we have our starting volume, we need to measure out the volume of our unknown. So we will be using about 50 milliliters. Again, we will be measuring the exact volume, and that's the important part. So fill up this graduated cylinder to about 50. Between the 49 and 50 mark. So we can estimate that as approximately 49.3 milliliters. Again, because our increments are to 1 milliliter increments, we can estimate that next decimal point. So now that we know the volume of our unknown or our analyte, we can put that into our Erlenmeyer flask. And Erlenmeyer flasks are usually used for titrations because they prevent splashing due to their tapered walls, and it will actually be useful to get our titrant into our solution that way. In order to fully deprotonate EDTA to make it a hexadentate ligand, we will need a little bit of hydrochloric acid. And so we can just add that to our unknown solution. A couple of drops, two or three is plenty. And that will then, when we add our EDTA, it will deprotonate it and allow us to completely chelate all of the iron that's in here. We also need a little bit of potassium thiocyanate that'll give us our color change. And this is basically acting as our indicator for this week. And as you can see, the color has already changed from that light orange to a very deep red. So what we'll see when we titrate is this color will go back to the orange, and that will tell us when to stop our titration. So at this point, we can go ahead and begin our titration. So we'll put our titration flask underneath our burette, slide just the tip of our burette into the Erlenmeyer flask. You don't want it touching any of the solution. Because I am right hand dominant, I will spin this around. So what you want to do is you want to control the stopcock with one hand and be able to swirl your flask with the other hand. So what I'll do is I will turn this on until I'm just starting to see droplets come out. Too much. And be swirling the flask the entire time. Titration is all about precision and patience. And what we'll see is each drop, it's difficult to see from where you're at, but as soon as that droplet hits the solution, that point turns the pale orange that we're looking for. However, when I swirl it, that color disappears. And what we'll see is one drop of our titrant will make the entire solution go pale orange. So the longer that pale orange color is sticking around tells us we need to slow down. We might be pretty close. If you ever have a droplet at the end, you can touch it to the wall of your Erlenmeyer flask and then swirl it around and it will capture that drop, which again, this is one of the other reasons why Erlenmeyer flasks are so useful for this. And that is looking pretty close to our original starting solution. So what we should do at this point is go ahead and record the volume that we've delivered. If we're unsure, let's see, 6.3, it looks like it's exactly on the 6.3 line, but again, we need to record this to two decimal places, so 6.30. And if you're ever unsure, you can always record that volume, add another drop, swirl it, and if you get a significant color change, keep going. You will need to record a new volume. If it doesn't significantly change, then you can just use the volume that you recorded. So that didn't look like it changed significantly, so we'll use the number we had. And at this point, sample is done. And if we were performing multiple trials, we would have another Erlenmeyer flask ready to go. We would slide into under, record our new starting volume, titrate until we get this orange color, record our final volume for however many trials we need. Since we're not going to do all three trials in this video, I will go ahead and move on to the calculations for a titration.